gonna hang up on you. You understand? I'm gonna talk about how you women have messed up our children. Listen, our men have went off to college and to prison and other places, and we left our children in your charge. Y'all messed us up. Lord have mercy. I know you're down the fritz getting high and your weeds is flying up in the air when I say that. And closing real quickly. That's the reason, one of the main reasons that it is. A lot of you women, Lord have mercy, put my foot in my mouth, care more about your hair than you do your kids, your children. Thank Lord have mercy. And I'm gonna tell you this, Miss Controversy. Ted says it so best when he says that we're not in control, God is in control. Yeah, when he, listen, you know, the more he says that, the more it resonates in my heart and soul, and God is in control. I'm going to give you an example. Now, one great member of the African American Museum was going to take his grandbaby to to do something, and he stopped to get her, and he said, well, I'm going to go up to the barber shop and get a haircut. And so he gets in his car, and right around the corner, right there on Noble Road, right before you get to Euclid, he pulls his car out out to the oncoming street, and here it comes. Bam! The police was chasing this young man, I think it was 19, 20 or something like that.
And
23. In his vehicle, bam, he runs into a Brother Hollister, and Brother Ted is going to take the story from there.
Yes, he ran into him and killed him. And killed him and killed himself too. Because when they took him to the hospital, he was dead. He died. And like Hollis, about a year ago, we were in the basement of the museum, Hollis and I. And he was telling me how he wanted to teach the youngsters, you know, the young boys that's getting in trouble, driving without license and getting in a lot of trouble and all. He wanted to teach them, you know, and the boy that hit him, he had a record of getting in trouble, you know, as far as driving crazy and doing a lot of stuff. So they were like meeting each other, you know, but that was a bad way to meet. Because like they were headed the same way, because he wanted to teach and the boy need mentoring, you know, and so we're not in control. So I don't know how that would work spiritually, but you know, they were like needing each other.
You know how I think it would work spiritually, Mr. Gearing, is that unfortunately this is something that happens to all of us. We don't know the circumstances or whatever. But what a wonderful tribute to Mr. Hollis,
yeah,
as we go forward and thinking about how he wanted to set up,
yes,
what he wanted to do,
yes,
with the African American Museum. And I see the plaque on the wall right now,
mm-hmm,
this room dedicated to Hollis Daryl Crump.
Right.
Okay. Stay out of my life. Okay, let's talk about somebody else's life. Okay, we're going to bring everybody into this conversation as we discuss,
yes,
Reggie Rucker. Okay?
Yeah.
Who remembers Reggie Rucker? Do you remember Reggie Rucker?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I don't even remember the name.
Okay. You remember the name. Okay. So, just to bring everybody up to date, unfortunately, Reggie Rucker has found himself in some trouble due to the fact that he misused some funds that were supposed to be for the Cleveland Peacemakers Alliance, an organization that he was involved with. But here's the second part of that, Art. The second part is, you know what he's claiming now, right?
What's he claiming?
He's claiming that because of an injury he's got from, you know, playing sports, this is what caused him to do what he did.
To gamble?
Yeah.
Listen. Philip Morris, you wrote an article some time ago, man. I got to pull it up. I know you remember it. Here's what you said, Philip Morris. You said that many organizations that get these grants, that get this funding, that get these millions of dollars, you said that as you look at their history, they haven't lived up to their expectations. In other words, many of these organizations just became program pimps. I'm not saying it in the words of you, Philip Morris, but it's in your column. You say you'd like to someday take a microscope and go over these organizations and see how many millions these organizations got and were they effective. And the reason you wrote that, Mr. Philip Morris, was because the plight in our community today, even though this money has been spread around, the plight in our community today is worse off than it has been. So if all this money spread it around to all these fine organizations, Lord have mercy, I'm not knocking them because a lot of them have done great work. But as a whole, I'm just talking about Philip Morris' article, all right? So as I lead right in, see, Miss Controversy don't know, I'm a genius at what I know. What I don't know, I'm not a genius, all right? But here's what I'm saying. I'm zeroing in right on the Peace Alliance program by Reggie Rucker, one of the great Cleveland Brown football players. Reggie Rucker was an arrogant SO, whatever you call it, from the beginning. And if you start wrong, you're going to end wrong. You understand? And that's how he started the Peace Alliance program. Now, the Peace Alliance program, oh, why'd you get me started on this? The Peace Alliance program was supposed to be an organization that was going to make peace with all the community organizations and therefore spread peace to the community. You know what Reggie Rucker and his selfish self, and what happens when you get money? He said, no, we ain't spreading this money around to all these organizations. Look, if you follow my instructions and you do what I say, I include you, and I include them. I don't care what they say. You understand? So he started wrong from the beginning. And once you start wrong, you're going to end wrong because all of a sudden, the great Philip Morris wrote several articles about Reggie Jackson and the great Peace Alliance, Reggie Rucker and the great, thank you, honey, and the great Peace Alliance program. You understand? Oh, they was getting all this money and they was going to do all this good and they was going to include all of us. Well, they didn't include
all of us.
As a matter of fact.
Shut the door on black on black.
Right, yeah, shut the door on black on black and many others. As a matter of fact, Lord, why do you bring this to me, Miss Controversy? As a matter of fact, we went to a meeting with Reggie Rucker and the Peace Alliance, and they wanted to jump on us.
Physically
jump on us. This is on the record. Reggie Rucker was so arrogant that, hey, instead, he even had nerve not to bring up, I know Ken Lance, and instead, as if he was some sort of gangster running a program. You understand? And some of his guys actually wanted to jump on me. In the end, we bought peace. We were in a meeting room at CMHA. Hey, listen, my brothers will tell you. You understand? I had about eight or nine of the Black Man Army and Black on Black with me. They'll tell you. You understand? And so Reggie Rucker was so arrogant. And I told Reggie Rucker, I said, Reggie Rucker, listen. We ain't worried about no money or nothing like that, but it's supposed to be the Peace Alliance. And in order for us, we've been working in the community for a long time. In order for us to help you and help the community, we need to be together. You understand? He shut us out the door then like he always shut us out the door. He shut us out the door just like the city of Cleveland, community relations shut us out the door. You say, how can you shut an organization out the door that's been working in the community for 30 years, doing the right and work for God? Yeah. How can you shut us out? You know why you shut us out? Because of petty politics and the fact that you sell yourself out for money, for a few pieces of silver and a few pieces of gold. And that's why Reggie Rucker's in the trouble he's in now. Ain't about no brain damage. The it's about greed.
He got brain damage.
Talk to me.
The brother say he got brain damage.
Yeah, he got brain damage. He got arrogant damage.
Okay.
Look, wait a minute. Strike everything I've said. This is Sunday. Miss Controversy, you put me in a spot that I really don't want to be in. This is Sunday.
Well, the truth is never wrong.
I wish the brother well.
Okay.
He probably have a family. He's going to do some time. Even though he's trying to wiggle out of that, which he probably will. But I wish him well. Anybody that's going through a struggle, I wish him well. But Reggie Rucker didn't treat us right, Philip Morris.
Yeah, it's it was an interesting thing. And just like you're talking about the Peace Alliance and what their goal was, and I know for a fact that some people that were working with him, some of the things that they did out here in the community, and they were very bold with what they were trying to do. He put them people at risk, and they didn't care. They were there to support the, you know, the goal. They were very goal driven. And unfortunately, as we see, you know,
Wait a minute. Listen. I know y'all gonna get mad with me. Ban me from the community. What? But look, goal driven is one thing. Mm-hmm. There is goal, spell goal, like goal.
Yeah, goals. G-O-A-L.
And then spell goal.
G-O-L-D.
All right, so there's a difference between goal.
And goal.
All right, okay, all right. And okay. And so what happened to the Peace Alliance, yeah, and Reggie Rucker? They got on the other?
Gold.
All right.
Gold.
Yes, gold. You understand? That's what happened to them. Okay. And I know they're mad with me, but I have to tell the truth the way it is. Let the chips fall where they may, all right?
Okay.
And furthermore, I'm going to let you go on with your with the rest of your thing. I didn't mean to get driven on this.
No, please.
But furthermore, in reality, Blaine Griffin, my friend, head of community relations, he didn't treat us right also. You see, he played politics. Listen, if you play politics with black folks' lives, if you play politics in our community, we get what we got now. Blood everywhere.
Yeah.
Devastation everywhere. Yeah. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Don't get me started on this. And listen, and he's still my friend. But I got to tell the truth. Listen, one thing about me on this program. Listen, I didn't come here, Miss Controversy, to do the breakdance. I didn't come here, you understand, the kissy kissy. I come here to keep it real. Now keep on moving before you really get me mad.
Okay, well, we don't want to get you upset.
No, you don't.
I mean, we understand the passion that you have for the black community and everything that you've been working towards. But here's the thing that I know now. When you talk about being on the front line for years and years, and we're not seeing the solutions to the issues come about as quickly as we would like. Okay, you know what it's like out there in the streets. Okay, do you think it's getting better or do you think it's getting worse?
Listen, it will never get better as long as you have, as the people with the money,
yeah,
you understand, continue to give the money to a certain little segment of the community who keep messing the money up over and over again. All right? And that's what's happening. If you check the record, the same, if they get $1 million together tomorrow, guess who it's going to? It's going to Brother Walker and the Safe Cleveland Initiative. They've been getting money for years and everything been the same, and they're gonna give it to those people that write these grants like you can dance. They write grants so good you start dancing, it sounds so good. But the results, as long as you got that, the community is gonna stay the same.
Okay, so let's paint a picture.
Yes.
Okay, paint me a picture. Let's talk about it just for a second. If the organizations that you feel that could make a difference were able to get some of these grants and funding, what would be some of the first, just give me an A, B, and C. Where would you start with this? If they told you right now, here you go, here's this money, what would your plan be? Because actually they were supposed to submit a plan even to get this money. So they submitted a plan, and if I'm going by what you
say,
they submitted a plan and nothing came about.
Listen, something came about.
What came about?
Don't let me twist this too much.
Okay.
There were some people, fine people, and a few organizations that did their best to do their best, all right?
Yeah.
I'm not slandering them, all right? I'm slandering the process itself. You say, I know individuals that work real hard with what they had, to do the best they can. So I'm not slandering them. Don't go out and run and tell everybody that I'm slandering everybody. I'm slandering the process. Look, in Iraq, they said this, and we knew better. They said, there are weapons of mass destruction. If you start wrong, you're gonna end wrong. If you start with a lie, you're gonna end with a lie. And that's what happened. The same way that happened in Iraq, mass destruction. Did we ever find them?
No.
No. The same thing with this program here. Mm-hmm. All right. I know I'm too deep for you, but
no,
let me,
it's not about being deep. It started with a lie.
It started with a lie.
Okay, we understand that now. All I'm asking, let's do some pipe dreaming.
Yes. It's not a pipe dream.
Okay. And asking our listeners, we're at 216-578-1490. Give me a A, B, and C. If you had an opportunity to change and turn around this city, how would you implement it? What would be the first thing you would do? I'm going to ask this question. Can I ask you, what about you, Judge Capers?
I'm just thinking about it.
Okay, she's thinking about it.
Listen.
You need more time to think.
The first thing that we must realize, and the Black Man Army realized that when we went out camping on 86th Street near where one of the worst catastrophes that ever happened in Cleveland, where the nine children and adults got burned up. Mm-hmm. We camped out there in the heart of what they call Seven All land, okay?
Yeah. What's the Seven All?
Seven All was supposed to be the most notorious gang at that time. We camped out there to show people that we weren't scared, okay?
About 3 days.
All right, yes, right. Yeah. You know, right, listen, what I say can be vindicated, yes. Yeah. Tents and all, okay? Yeah. Slap on the ground, mm-hmm. All right? So here's the point. While we were there, here's what happened. We couldn't believe it. The women started coming up and said, men, men, men. We started looking around. Men, men. We said, men? Those are over there by the store and all that. Those are men. No, we talking about real men, men, men. Those men over there, they just helping mess up the kids. We talking about, and they start hugging us, and they welcome us, and mm-hmm. they greeted us. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You understand? So here's what I found out. I found out that there were many females in the community, mothers, as we walked around. They had these little children, they had these sons. Look, some of them two, three, 4 years old. They couldn't control them. They needed men. That's why they were so glad. One lady came and said, look, this is my 4-year-old boy. I can't have it. We look. You can't have my 4-year-old boy. You know what I'm saying? We need men.
Yeah.
Men.
That's on the real.
So the first thing our community needs is not devices. Here's what has happened. They threw this money, just like you throw a bunch of bones they threw this little crumbs in between us. And so we're not together. So first of all, you understand, money doesn't mean anything if you're all fighting over it. Mm-hmm. So first of all, you get the money and you kind of spread it equally or a little bit so everybody can be a little satisfied. Mm-hmm. And then everybody go out and do the work.
Yeah.
You understand? And then the women will see real men and they will gravitate to us and we'll be able to help save their children. Because the biggest problem right now is really and truly there's so many mothers out here that really can't handle these young guys, and they're reaching out for help. They want help. So the first thing is, you love the Fatherhood Initiative program.
Yes.
Really, we need a Motherhood Initiative because the mothers is the really one that's struggling with these boys. When we go to the juvenile, oh, I need help, and I put them in the juvenile, mm-hmm. and it made them worse.
Yeah.
You understand? So that's. They really need help. Think about this, sister. You've been looking for something to do. A Motherhood Initiative program where we can help these mothers.
Okay. Well, welcome back to the Art McCoy University Radio Show. This is Miss Controversy, and we have a wonderful guest joining us today, Miss Latasha Carter, who is the marketing and sales coordinator for the Universoul Circus. How are you, Latasha?
I'm doing great.
Good, good. I'm so glad that we were able to give you some wonderful weather here in Cleveland.
Yes, yes. I came straight from California. When I got here, it was snowing, but it was beautiful to me. But it cleared up rather quickly, and it's been just beautiful days here. I really like it here in Cleveland.
I'm so glad. She's joining us today because we're going to talk to you, all of our listeners, about the Universoul Circus that's coming here to Cleveland May 17th to May 30th. And it's going to be the big tent. They're going to set it up over at Southgate USA, right on Northfield and Warrensville in the old Target parking lot. Is that right, Latasha?
Yes. Well,
yeah, it's
Southgate,
in the
Southgate, USA.
Right, in the old Target parking lot. So this is like Bedford Heights, right? Because that's my neighborhood.
It's actually Maple Heights. Yeah, we were in Bedford Heights, but it actually the venue switched. So I'm glad I'm here to let everybody know.
Okay, excellent, excellent. So the Universoul Circus, it's from and got started from Atlanta, Georgia. And this is a black-owned circus, so this has got to be a record in itself, right, Latasha?
It is. It really is. The owner, Mr. Walker and Mrs. Walker, they've been doing this going on 23 years now. And it's for us, by us, with acts from all over the world, over 27 countries are represented. You have the Ethiopian group, but Trinity is awesome. We have trapeze artists from China. We have dancers from Trinidad and Tobago. It's just a really international event of great proportions. It's wonderful.
You know what? I know that it is. And anyone that has not gone or seen the Universoul Circus, I just want to encourage you right now as you're listening to our show, because Latasha let me know that today, okay, is actually the last day that you will be able to get tickets for the $17.50 price. Okay, so for $17.50, you can get tickets for the last time today at that discounted price, right?
Yes, ma'am. All you have to do is go to Ticketmaster and enter keyword circus, and you can grab those tickets. It's pretty much for any day, any time, $17.50. We also have $10 tickets available in the mornings at 10:30. We do have AM shows, so any groups of 20 or more, you can get the morning show tickets for only $10 each.
You know, I think that's great. And, you know, the pricing on the Universoul Circus, I think, is really wonderful. I think the Universoul Circus does a wonderful job in trying to make it affordable for anyone that would like to come. Because I've been to other circuses, and it's a pretty penny, you know. but I think that they do a wonderful job at bringing the circus to the community and then making it affordable for people that want to go. You have a lot of other, well, not a lot of other, but one other special thing that people can do to try to win tickets, right?
Yes, we do. Actually, through this weekend, we are doing a text to win campaign where you can simply text best circus ever, that's all one word, to 72727. And you will receive a text message, and the winners will be chosen on Tuesday. We'll notify you via text.
Okay, so you could find out by Tuesday whether you won tickets or not to the best circus ever, the Universoul Circus. You know, what I like about besides just the few acts that you were talking about, the international acts, who goes and finds these people? Do you know, Latasha?
I do. Actually, the owner himself actually goes. He travels the world looking for new talent. And since we've been around so long, a lot of our talent started as children, and then they've grown with the circus, and it's like one big family. So he actually scopes out and looks for talent all over the world.
That's wonderful. And not to give a spoiler or anything, but does the Universoul Circus have animals?
We do.
Okay, so you gotta come to the circus. We don't want to say what animals are going to be there, not right now. We don't want to give a spoiler, but let's just say that whatever atmosphere that you might have remembered as a child of what a circus would be, this is like a soul circus. So I really feel the soul in the participation from the people, the music that's played, the acts that the music they perform to. You really feel the soul, and that's what that's all about.
You really do. It's the most interactive event, you know, you'll probably ever go to. And I've been to a lot of different events, and it's so hard to impress me these days because I work for Universoul Circus. So we have the Soul Train line that we do, which is just hilarious at times. We have a Think You Can Dance segment where we actually have volunteers from the audience come, and that's so much fun. We have music that we can relate to, you know. It's just very feels like one big family reunion, really.
And that's wonderful. So, Judge, we have got to get you, and we're going to go, and we're going to go see the Universoul Circus, since you've never been.
I'll certainly be glad.
Well, let me tell you something. There's nothing like Ringling Brothers, okay?
No.
Because they truly put the soul in Universoul. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So just to let our listeners know, you can give us a call at 216-578-1490. Maybe you want to talk to Latasha. Latasha, do people still run away to join the circus anymore?
Well, I did.
Okay. Yeah. Tell us about that. Because how does one get a job working at a circus?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. It's just timing and God. I was in a position where I was able to run away with the circus, not really being tied down, you know, with any big responsibilities. So I was able to go, and I come from radio. I used to work for a radio station, and that's how I met, the folks in the marketing department that work for Universoul.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And they offered me the position, and I jumped at it because my major is Black Studies with a minor in entrepreneurship, and you know, I'm finally using that degree, so.
Oh, well, that's wonderful. And that's funny how God will bring you around and enable you to do the things that
Definitely.
You want to do.
Yeah.
And this is what's so wonderful about the Universoul Circus. You know, it's all people of color, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I like the fact that not just the staff, okay, is a diverse staff, but, you know, the entertainment that they're bringing in. But we all feel a connection. Do you feel connected to your coworkers in that way as well?
I do. I do.
It's
sorry, there's a comment. Yeah. So I do. I feel very connected. It's like a family. It's a great experience to work with them.
Okay, I could imagine. What do you think that has been the major success of the Universoul Circus? Is it the fact that they specifically go into Black communities and actively, this is not like something that, or a venue downtown or something like that. This is always a place where we're able to get to.
Right.
You know, it's not anything far. So how has it been as you travel, you know, through the United States and dealing with the different communities?
And here is, you know, a good point, and it's intentional. We intentionally come to where we are.
Okay.
Yeah, to make it easy, and it's very important for us, for the locals to see the show. I mean, we give away a lot of complimentary tickets to nonprofits, and you know, because it's important for us to make sure that a lot of at-risk youth see themselves, see us doing amazing things. So we try and keep the ticket price affordable, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
And we just try and create a once in a lifetime experience for a lot of people, but it's become like generational. You know, so many folks, I was speaking to my brother here, and he went when he was 8 or 9, and you know, he's probably, you have kids now?
No, I don't.
Well, if he had kids, he would be taking them. So it's just being around so long, it's just become really generational and tradition, and we love that.
Right. I don't think a lot of people realize just what you were saying before, that the Universoul Circus has been in existence for 23 years. Mm-hmm. You know, have you always been touring? Because, you know, you've come to Cleveland a couple of times. Well, was there a time when it was just maybe located in Atlanta or some other southern, or you know, now you're in California, so you travel all of the United States?
We do, and when Mandela was alive, we actually were requested to come to South Africa.
Oh, wow.
So we did that as well. So we're international. This year we're just here in the United States, but we have two tours going on. We are actually in California and New York right now simultaneously. So it's really grown. It started, you know, just one, you know, and then it's grown leaps and bounds. So, and we hope to continue that growth.
And that's what's, you know, part of what our show is all about, is about, you know, empowering the Black community. And I think, you know, even with something that is so big and, I don't know how to even put it, like a circus.
Mm-hmm.
Most Black people can't even imagine being able to work in a circus or participate, but going to the circus here in Cleveland, I mean, I think the big circus comes here to town, but you know, it's just out of reach for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And that's what's so important about the Universoul Circus, is because it's not just entertainment, but it's also sending a message. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I went to the Universoul Circus one of their first times that they came to Cleveland, and they reenacted a song from Kirk Franklin's New Nation album. And were you there? Were you there when they had that flying black Jesus? Did you see that?
Did I miss that?
Okay.
I don't remember that one, but okay. I remember the song.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. You remember that song. But let me tell you something. The Universoul Circus did something that even to this day, it gives me goosebumps thinking about it. Because as they redid this song, they reenacted it, but they had rigged up a line, and they had a gentleman that was dressed like Jesus, and people started screaming, people was falling out. It was awesome. It was absolutely awesome. It still gives me goosebumps to this day thinking about it. It really does. Black-owned circus from Atlanta, Georgia, the Universoul Circus. What else you got to say about that, Art?
What I got to say is this, that for those that have experienced this circus, you know what it's about, and you don't want to miss it. And for those that who have not, somewhere down the line, we're going to wrestle some real tickets out of our guests, and we're going to be able to present them close to the time they come on. But what we want to do is we want to pack the rafters. We're going to have them coming all out the rafters to the Universoul Circus right here in Cleveland. And we're going to get, are you going to be here in the back office somewhere? We're going to be able to see you personally.
I will be here. Right now, what I do want to say is we do have a local group. Well, we have groups that we put together. And if anyone has a group over 20, you can actually contact me personally, and we'll get you group rates to go to Universoul Circus. So if you know of any daycares, senior centers, you know, just any church groups, please reach out to me. I'll give you, or you can reach out to the station, and they will actually, you know, pass that information along to me.
Okay, excellent.
Next week, you know, one thing that has completely eluded me is the program that I usually do this time of year when basketball season, because I know that I have a special listening audience. I have to talk about how you women, most of you, a lot of you all, not all of you all, have messed up our children. Lord have mercy. Again, always one of the hottest shows. I always have picket lines outside, women talking about me. But nevertheless, sooner or later, this show is going to go on. How you women have messed up our children. And if any woman call in when I have this program talking about it's the men's fault, I'm going to hang up on you.